أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Imam al-Bukhari, he narrates a very beautiful story in the Sahih. He narrates the story that occurred between Abu Darda radiallahu anhu and Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhuma. Now, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he made the hijrah to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he moved into this new land, this new city that he himself is not too familiar with. And the Sahaba that lived in Mecca, they were not too familiar with how life was going in Medina. So because of this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what he did was that he made a bond of brotherhood between the companions. The companions who left their homes in Mecca, the companions who migrated for miles and miles to reach Medina, those companions who were not familiar with Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he paired them up with the companions who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they were from Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the wisdom behind him doing this was that so those companions that lived with him in Mecca, when they are paired up with the companions that are residents of Medina, the companions from Mecca will be able to teach the companions from Medina, and the companions from Medina, they will be able to teach the companions who are coming into Medina for the first time. Teach them the ropes, teach them how, you know, how life goes in Medina, right? To introduce them to this new city, this new land, how the business works, how life works in this new land. So this was a very wise decision that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he made. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made a bond of brotherhood between Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu and Abu Darda. Now Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he was already a resident of Medina. Abu Darda al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, one day Salman radiallahu anhu wanted to visit Abu Darda. Now Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he wasn't home. But Salman, he didn't know that. So when Salman came to the house, he knocked on the door and he was waiting for Abu Darda to respond to him. Now upon his surprise, Salman radiallahu anhu, the one that he sees at the door is Abu Darda's wife, Ummu Darda radiallahu anha. Now Salman radiallahu anhu, he asks her, where's Abu Darda? And she says, he's out, running, on an errand, he's doing something, he'll be back shortly. So Abu, Salman radiallahu anhu, he sees that Abu Darda's wife is wearing like really strange clothes. He sees that she's wearing like shabby clothes. It's kind of weird. So Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, "Ma sha'nuk?" He says, "Why are you dressed like this? Why is your condition like this?" So Ummu Darda radiallahu anha, she said that أخوك Abu Darda, she says, "Your brother Abu Darda, ليس له حاجة في الدنيا." He doesn't want to have anything to do with this dunya. So Salman radiallahu anhu, he's like, okay, that's kind of strange, kind of weird. But Salman radiallahu anhu, he didn't say anything. So Salman, he waited a while until Abu Darda came home. Abu Darda, he comes home, and Abu Darda, he invites Salman into his house. Abu Darda is like, come inside, I'll get you some food, inshallah. So Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he gets his wife, you know, and they prepare the food for Salman. Now Abu Darda in the living room, you know, Abu Darda, he brings out the food to Salman. And Salman al-Farisi, I mean, it's already getting weird. He already sees that Abu Darda's wife is wearing shabby clothes. Now we're going to see what happens next. Abu Darda, he gives Salman the food. And Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he says to Salman, "Kul fa inni sa'im." Abu Darda, he says to Salman that you eat because I'm fasting, I'm not going to eat. So Salman radiallahu anhu, you know, we know it's from amongst the etiquettes, right? The good etiquettes is that we honor our guests. And this is something good that Abu Darda was doing. But he didn't want to eat with Salman because he was fasting. So Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he tells Salman, you know, you eat because I'm fasting. Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, "Ma ana bi'akilin hatta ta'kul." He said, "I'm not going to eat until you eat." Now Abu Darda was fasting. Now can you imagine, he's, you know, Salman wants him to break his fast. And we know this is permissible if it's a recommended fast. We're not talking about the fast of Ramadan. If it's a recommended fast, it's permissible to break it. In case you're hungry, and you know, in case it's getting very difficult upon you, you can break your fast if it's a recommended, optional fast, not Ramadan. So don't think, oh, you know, you heard from brother, you know, Brother Zakaria in the khutbah that, you know what, when Ramadan comes, you can break. You know, I don't want to see the brothers, you know, having cookies, you know, snacks and chips, and I see him eating during the day of Ramadan. We don't want to see that. But Salman radiallahu anhu, he tells him, you better eat, because if you don't eat, I'm not going to eat. So Abu Darda is like, fine, you know what, I'll eat. So then they both eat. Salman, he stays with Abu Darda the whole day, and he sleeps over at his house. We're having a sleepover here. So Salman radiallahu anhu and Abu Darda, they go to sleep. And they sleep next to each other. Abu Darda wakes up in the middle of the night to go pray tahajjud. Salman radiallahu anhu told him, "Nam, go to sleep. Don't get up right now." Abu Darda is like, "What? You know, you're asking me about my wife having shabby clothes. Now you're making me break my fast and eat. Now you don't want me to pray Qiyamul Layl. What's going on?" But he didn't say anything to Salman. He's like, "Fine, I'll go to sleep. I don't want to argue. I'll just go to sleep." So he goes to sleep and Salman goes to sleep. Abu Darda, he wakes up again to go and pray Qiyamul Layl. So Salman tells him again to go to sleep. Abu Darda is like, "What? I want to pray Qiyamul Layl. This is like my nightly routine. I want to pray." So he tells him, "Go to sleep." And they both go to sleep again. And until the last part of the night, until the night was about to go away and Fajr was about to come in, Salman radiallahu anhu, he wakes up. And he says, "Al-an qum." He says, "Get up now." And then they both prayed. They both prayed Qiyamul Layl before Salatul Fajr. Now right after their Qiyamul Layl, right after their Tahajjud that they prayed together, Salman radiallahu anhu, he turns to Abu Darda and he says to him, he says, "Oh Abu Darda." And Abu Darda, can you imagine, like, your guest is telling you how to live your life. Your guest is telling you you can't fast. Your guest is telling you when to pray, when you can't pray. So Abu Darda, you can imagine, he's, you know, perhaps he feels some way, like, why is Salman doing this? So Salman tells him, "Oh Abu Darda, inna li rabbika alayka haqqa," that your Lord has a right over you. "Wa li nafsika alayka haqqa," and your soul, yourself, your body has a right over you. "Wa li ahlika alayka haqqa," and your family has a right over you. "Fa'a'ti kulla dhi haqqin haqqahu." "Fa'a'ti kulla dhi haqqin haqqahu." So give everybody their due right. Give everybody their right. Do not lean towards one aspect of Islam and neglect the other aspects of Islam. So Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, when he heard this, you know, he was kind of puzzled. He's like, "What do you mean?" So Abu Darda went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam heard what Salman said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Sadaqa Salman." Salman has spoken the truth. And we know that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whenever he affirms something, whenever he agrees with something, that is from his sunnah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying that Salman is right. So let's just look at this whole story. What do we get from this story? The fact is that when Salman came to the home, he saw that Abu Darda, he wasn't fulfilling the rights of his family as best as he could. Abu Darda, you know, he thought that by being a Muslim, we're going to have to wear shabby clothes. By being a Muslim, I'm going to fast every day and I'm not going to eat. By being a Muslim, I'm going to deprive myself of sleep and I'm not going to sleep in the night. I'm going to pray all night. So Salman is telling him, you know, take it easy. Islam, you know, this is not what Islam is. Islam is giving everybody their due right. So in this story, we see that Abu Darda, he did not give his wife her full rights, right? He made her wear shabby clothes. In this story, we see that Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he didn't give himself the proper rights. Rather, what he did is that he tried to stay up at night. He tried to stay up at night. He deprived himself of sleep. He deprived himself of food because he wanted to fast during the day. So Salman is telling him, you know what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has rights over you, but your body has rights over you, and your wife and your family, they have rights over you as well. So this beautiful hadith teaches us that we need to have a balance in Islam. We need to have a balance in Islam. Islam is not just about coming to the masjid. Islam is not just about reading Quran and then you forget about everything else. And you find some brothers, they're like this, some brothers and sisters, they want to seek knowledge. They want to seek knowledge, but they don't want to work. They say, you know what, dad, I just want to seek knowledge. I don't want to work. I don't want to take care of my wife. I don't want to take care of my kids. And this is a problem. This is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us about these three rights. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells in a hadith recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, ittaqillaha haythuma kunt. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever you are. This is the rights of who? The rights of Allah, that you are conscious of Him wherever you are. Whether you're with your family, whether you're in the masjid sitting down here right now, whether you're at work with the non-Muslims, you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever you are. That's the right of Allah. وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. And follow up a bad deed with a good deed, and it's going to wipe it away. This is the right of yourself. You have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you for the bad deeds that you do, and you have to follow up those bad deeds with good deeds. This is the right of your own self. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He doesn't benefit in any way from you following up your bad deeds with good deeds. It makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased, but it diminishes nothing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you don't want to do that. So this is the right of yourself. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he then says, وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. And treat the people well. Treat the people well. So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sums up our entire life. Each and every single one of us, you have three things that you have to worry about. Three things. You have the rights of Allah, that you fear Him wherever you are. The rights of yourself, and that is that you follow up your bad deeds with good deeds. And the right of the people, and that is that you treat them well. How beautiful is this hadith? So in life, you have these three things, and these three things alone. You have your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have your relationship with yourself, and you have your relationship with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you'll be asked about all of these three things. You'll be asked about all of these three things. When it comes to the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are some people, they do everything for everybody else. They do everything for themselves, but they forget about Allah. They fulfill the rights of the people, they may fulfill the rights of themselves, but they forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all He wants from us is to worship Him alone and not to associate any partners with Him. That's what Allah wants you to do. That's it. For you to obey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and for you to stay away from the things that He has prohibited you from, and that you do not disobey Him. That's all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do. But what do? We turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith in Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, ta'isa abdu dinar, ta'isa abdu dirham. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, may the slave of the dinar and the dirham perish. May he perish, may he be destroyed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, may the slave of money be destroyed. There are some people, they have Muslim names, they are raised in Muslim families, but that's all they have of Islam is the name. They may come for Jum'ah, they may come for Ramadan, but Salah, Zakah, practicing Islam, the rights of Allah, who cares? Who cares? They may be the nicest people in the world, but Allah, who cares? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us about this on the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us about this on the Day of Judgment. Right? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he describes the people that chase money, the people that chase this world. He describes them as the slaves of the dinar and the dirham, the slaves of money, the slaves of dollars. And he makes dua against these people. So we need to make sure that we are not neglectful of the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Allah azza wa jalla, He says in the Quran, إِنَّهُ مَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah azza wa jalla, He says that those who commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who commit acts of polytheism, they leave Islam and they worship idols, they worship other things besides Allah. Allah says that those who commit shirk, acts of polytheism with Allah, Allah has made Jannah haram for him. Allahu Akbar. Jannah will be haram for the people who die upon shirk and kufr and disbelief. So imagine how serious shirk is. Now some people, they may say, you know what? I know this person, he's Hindu, this person is Christian, this person is a Jew. You know, they don't worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person is atheist. He doesn't worship Allah, but he's a nice guy. We hear this all the time. How is this guy going to go to Jahannam if he dies upon disbelief, but he's such a nice guy? My neighbor, he gives me a big smile every time I see him. He gives me presents. He says, hey, you know, every time I see him, he's such a nice guy. He watches my house when I go on vacations, right? He gives me a big hug every time I see him. He asks me how my family is doing. These people are such nice people. How come these believers will go to the fire? You have to remember that there are three rights. This person may fulfill your right and be so nice to you. This person may not rob you, may not steal from you, may treat you nice. But he's forgetting the biggest right, and that is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they come to you, they treat you nice, they give you a big hug, they say, MashaAllah, Allahu Akbar, they give you a hug and a kiss, and they ask you about your family, and they're the nicest brothers in the masjid. But you find out that this guy neglects his wife. This guy doesn't take care of his family. What would you say about this person? Would you say that this is a person of good character? Even though he's a nice guy with you, but he's neglecting the rights of his family. What about somebody who neglects the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The one that gave them life, the one that gave them everything that they have, they give everybody their love, except the one who deserves it the most. So this is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, those who commit shirk with Allah, Allah has made Jannah haram for them. Even if they mean, they may be nice to people. So this is the answer. You know, when somebody comes up to you and they say, how is somebody going to be in the fire? Because there's, because they don't worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they're such nice people. Is because they may fulfill the rights of the people, they may fulfill the rights of themselves, but they forgot about the most important right, and that is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So brothers and sisters, all Allah azza wa jal wants us to do is to worship Him alone. Now somebody might hear this khutbah, they may say, you know what, Brother Zakaria, you're speaking about non-Muslims, what about the Muslims? What about the Muslims? How do we fulfill the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Just because you're a Muslim doesn't mean that you can't commit any shirk. Just because you are Muslim and your name is Muhammad, Abu Bakr, whatever your name is, doesn't mean that you can never do any acts of polytheism. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says to the Sahaba, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says to them, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَفُ عَلَيْكُمْ الشِّرْكُ الْأَصْغَرُ. The thing that I fear for you the most is minor shirk. And the companions, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is minor shirk? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, الرياء, it is showing off. You have some people, you may memorize Quran, you may be, you may dress as a Muslim, you may have the perfect hijab, you may have the perfect beard, you may be growing your beard, everything from outside is following the sunnah. You got a miswak in your pocket, you got your thobe above your ankle, you got a beard, kufi, thobe, whatever it is. But shirk can also creep up into your actions, and that is that you show off with your acts of worship. That's going against the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So really, these three rights, don't ever think that, you know what, I'm a Muslim, I said my shahada, mashallah, I just have to worry about fulfilling the rights of the people and myself. No. No, you must always focus on fulfilling the rights of Allah azza wa jal. So that's when it comes to the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people fulfill the rights of others, but they forget about the most important right. What about the rights of ourselves? We've mentioned the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةِ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا, and follow up a bad deed with a good deed. This is the rights of yourself. You have rights over yourself. You have rights over yourself. Allah will ask you how you dealt with your own body. How did you treat your own body? How did you use these hands? How did you use this tongue that you have? How did you use these ears that you have? How did you use these feet? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that those who do not fulfill the rights of their own bodies, Allah, He says, يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ وَأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah, He says that on the day of judgment, these people that they may have tried to fulfill the right of Allah, they may be so nice to people, but they forget about themselves. Allah, He says that on that day, their tongues will bear witness against themselves. Their hands will bear witness against themselves. And their feet will bear witness against themselves. On the day of judgment, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. But those people who forgot about themselves, forgot about fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it relates to their own bodies, their hands will say, oh Allah, He used me to touch himself in a haram way. He used me to touch others in a haram way. Oh Allah, He used me to disobey you, oh Allah. The tongues of these people will say, oh Allah, He used me to curse. He used this same tongue, He used me to curse against his parents, to curse against others. He used me to disobey you, oh Allah. The feet will say, oh Allah, He used me to walk towards the opposite gender, this girl's house or that guy's house, to do this haram. Oh Allah, He used me. The feet will say, oh Allah, He used me to walk towards haram. And there's many ayat in the Quran like this. So remember that your body has a right over you. And the right of the body is to forbid your body from the haram desires that you have. From fulfilling those desires that you have in a haram way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Allah azza wa jalla, he says, as for those who fears the standing of his Lord and he forbids his nafs from desires, then Jannah will be his, you know, his home. Jannah will be his place of resting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Jannah is going to be for those people who stop themselves. You know, we have inclinations. You know, we like the opposite gender. We have inclinations to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you need to stop that. You're being tested with your desires. But some people, you know what? They're like, whatever. I don't care. Allah is watching me. Who cares? I don't even believe in Allah anyway. My parents raised me as a Muslim. There may be a God, but who cares? I'm a good person. I'm good to others. But these people, they forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they forget about their own selves. So these people on the Day of Judgment, because they forgot about their own selves, their own bodies will testify against them on the Day of Judgment. Allahu Akbar. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. So really, you cannot hide on the Day of Judgment. You cannot hide on the Day of Judgment. And we see from the hadith of Salman radiallahu anhu that he says to Abu Darda that your body has a right over you. Your body has a right over you. And from the rights of your body is that you treat it right. You know, there are so many Muslims. We're not talking about non-Muslims. We're talking about Muslims, people who believe in Allah. They're still smoking. They're still looking up fatwas from the scholars that say it's makruh, it's only disliked. But they're killing their bodies. They're destroying their bodies with these disgusting cigarettes. And not only that, they come to the masjid and the breath is terrible. You can't even concentrate in your salah because of that stink smell. So brothers and sisters, have some shyness. Have, you know, fulfill the rights of your own body. It's one thing, you know, it's one thing doing that action by yourself, but don't do it in front of the brothers. Don't do it in front of the sisters at the masjid. Because not only that, now you're harming the rights of the people. Not only are you harming yourself and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by going against his rights, by harming your own body, but you're going to be harming others as well. So brothers and sisters, this, you know, from the rights of your body, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in Surah An-Nisa, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, and don't kill yourselves. This is from the rights of ourselves. How much people are committing suicide? They're fed up with life and they're committing suicide. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, do not kill yourself. This is from the rights of yourself that you take care of your body. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he tells us, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. He says, all of you are shepherds and you will all be asked about your flocks. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we fear him in regards to our relationship with him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we fear him in regards to the relationship, you know, between us and our own selves. أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة الله وسلامه على عباده الذين اصطفى وبعد. Now we've spoken about the rights of Allah Azza wa Jal. We spoke about the rights of ourselves. Now inshallah ta'ala we're going to speak about the rights of the people. And this is something that wallahi is so practical because we deal with each other on a daily basis. We deal with each other on a daily basis. Allah will ask us about how we dealt with each other. There are some Muslims, they may have beards, they may, you know, from the outward appearance, they look like they're practicing Islam so much. And sometimes we trust these people. We trust that, you know, if this person is practicing Islam on an outward level, then they should also be fulfilling the rights of themselves and they should be fulfilling the rights of the people. What are some rights that we have over each other? The rights that all of you have over me right now is that I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not going to cheat you. I'm not going to steal from you. But there are some Muslims. They may worship Allah. They may read Quran. They may memorize Quran. But they neglect the rights of others. What you find, wallahi, and this is the most painful, when your own Muslim brother robs you. And wallahi, so many brothers have come to me in various masajid with these problems of community members. You have your brother, he's praying with you, shoulder to shoulder, but he tells you, yo, akhi, I'm going to get you a job, inshallah. Right? Just give me some money, you know, I'm going to hold it down for you, I'm going to give it to the boss, whatever the case is. And he lies to you. He lies through his teeth like a snake. And he prays Jum'ah with you. He says, assalamu alaikum to you. But he doesn't care about cheating you and stealing from you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us, man ghashana falaysa minna. Whoever cheats us is not from us. Is not from us. So if you want to, you know, mashallah, you want to come for Ramadan, you want to read Quran, you want to be, you know, a good Muslim, but then you want to cheat people, you want to lie to people, you want to steal from people, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you about this. Don't ever think that you're going to get away from it. Don't ever think that you're going to get away from it. The Prophet ﷺ, one time he asked the Sahaba, he said, "Atadruna man al-muflis?" He said, "Do you know who the bankrupt person is?" So the Sahaba, they said, the bankrupt person is the guy who has no money, no dirham, no mata', he has no money, he has no goods, he has nothing under his name, he is broke. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, no. Al-muflis, the muflis, the bankrupt person is the guy who is going to come on the day of judgment. Yati yawm al-qiyamah, he will come on yawm al-qiyamah. Bi salatin wa siyamin wa zakatin. He's going to come on the day of judgment with salah. He's going to have qiyam al-layl. He's going to have his five daily prayers that he's praying, mashallah. These are all good things. He's coming with siyam. He's fasting in Ramadan. He's coming with zakah. So many Muslims don't even pay their zakah. But the bankrupt guy is a guy who's going to come with salah. He's going to come with fasting. And he's going to come with zakah. So this person is fulfilling the rights of Allah. He's fulfilling the rights of Allah, but the Prophet ﷺ is going to show us how he neglects the rights of the people, and because of that, he will be thrown into the fire. The Prophet ﷺ says, this guy, he's going to come with so much good deeds. وَقَدْ شَتَمَ هَذَا But he cursed this person. وَضَرَبَ هَذَا But he hit this person. وَقَذَفَ هَذَا And he falsely accused this person. وَسَفَكَ دَمَ هَذَا And he shed the blood of this person. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, فَيَأْخُذُ فَيُعْطَى هَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ وَهَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ وَهَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ So this person that he cursed will take from his good deeds. This person that he hit will take from his good deeds. This person that he cheated and he stole from will take from his good deeds. Until he has no more good deeds left. Imagine all of these people that you're backbiting. The scholars of the past, when they would hear that somebody is backbiting, they would take a gift to his house. And when the guy would open the door, he would say, Sheikh, what's this gift for? The Sheikh would say, I heard that you from trustworthy sources that you backbit me, you spoke trash about me, so I'm giving you this gift now to pay you for those good deeds that I'm going to get from you on the day of judgment. So imagine, brothers, you're praying salah, you have so many good deeds. If you hate a brother, don't speak badly about him. Don't backbite him, don't talk trash about him behind his back. Because you may not like the brother, but don't give him your good deeds. Don't give him your good deeds. Even if you may not like somebody, somebody is mean to you or something, don't give him your good deeds. That's the worst thing you could possibly do. So the Prophet ﷺ tells us that these people that you wrong, they're going to take from your good deeds. But it doesn't end there. When your account of good deeds is at zero, you're going to be in the negative. When you have no more good deeds to give these people, you're going to take their bad deeds. فَيَأْخُذُ مِنْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ He's going to take from their bad deeds. And then the Prophet ﷺ tells us, that then ثُمَّ طُرِحَ فِي النَّارِ Then this person will be thrown into the fire of Jahannam. We seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection. So if you think that you can cheat from people, if you think you can cheat people, you can harm people, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells us, الْمُسْلِمُ مَنْ سَلِمَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ وَفِي رِوَايَةً الْمُسْلِمُ مَنْ سَلِمَ النَّاسُ مِنْ لِسَانِهِ وَيَدِهِ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells us that the Muslim is the one by which the people is safe from his hands and his tongue. The people are safe from your hands and your tongues. So remember this, brothers and sisters, that you may get away with something. You may get away with something, but you will never get away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like I said, you have people who focus on Islam, and they focus on practicing Islam and in the relationship with Allah, but they forget about the people. There are people, and it's not just about apparent forms of abuse, but it could be even hidden forms of abuse, like at your job. Your boss is paying you money to work 8 hours a day, but you're goofing off 6 hours of the day, and he's only, really, you only deserve to be paid for 2 hours. Allah will ask you about this on the day of judgment. Allah has given you children to take care of, but you neglect them. I don't care about teaching them about Islam. They could be a Christian, a Jew, who cares? Allah will ask you about these children that He has given you to take care of. Allah will ask you about your family members. Allah Azza wa Jal will ask you about everything that is under your responsibility. Right? Everything that is under your responsibility. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal that the best day that we ever live is the day that we meet Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the best day that we ever live in this dunya is our last days. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He make the best deeds that we ever do our last deeds. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells us, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ That the deeds that you do, they are determined by the last deeds that you do. By the last deeds that you do. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal that He help all of us fulfill His rights and the rights of ourselves and the rights of our fellow members of creation. And brothers and sisters, it's not just for the Muslims. Don't ever think that, you know what, the rights of the people are just the rights of the Muslims. No, it's for everybody as well. Everybody. The Prophet ﷺ, he says that a Muslim is the one that the people are safe from his hands and his tongue, even non-Muslims. Even non-Muslims. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we fulfill all of these rights. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we remember this on a daily basis. Because brothers and sisters, this is so important. Your entire life revolves around these three things. رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وأقيم الصلاة.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.